Hello everyone, my name is Urfi. I work in Lutheran General, and we love to partner with Christ Medical Center. And just like Christ, we have a neuro ICU in Lutheran General now. And Nick asked me to give a talk on how neurologists would approach delirium in the ICU. So no disclosures for me. And the outline of my talk is confusion, delirium, or altered mental status. We use these terms a lot in the ICUs, and I'll tell you my perspective, what I mean by it, and how I try to localize a lesion being a neurologist. What are the common causes and the differential diagnosis for me? How do I like to manage confusion briefly? And some interesting clinical cases that I have been through in managing altered mental status in the ICU. So altered mental status, it's a broad term, and it's a range of abnormalities of cognition that we see. It goes from being slightly altered from normal function to being in a comatose state. So just wanted to lay it out that it's a very broad term, and we usually treat it as in a broad spectrum manner as well. My approach to the altered mental status, as you can see, stupor, agitated, lethargy, coma, psychosis, encephalopathy, all are included in the delirium picture, or the approaching the confused patient. Sometimes I see the confusion where the delirium is considered separately compared to the altered mental patient. But for me, all these terms are inclusive, and when I'm not able to find any particular diagnosis, then I use the term toxic metabolic encephalopathy. But I look for the specific focal causes in the confused patient. Common causes and differential diagnosis. You'll see differential diagnosis is usually broad and can be multifactorial. A patient can have a seizure and can have a stroke at the same time. Patient can have a toxic metabolic encephalopathy and can have seizures. So, or can have meningitis. So it can be multifactorial, and a lot of cases it is a multifactorial diagnosis. So we have to look for risk factors. Clinical presentation and clinical examination can help us in narrowing the differential diagnosis for the altered patient in the ICU. For me, and this is a very key point for me, a focused neurological assessment. I cannot overemphasize this point. A lot of times I talk to the residents and the fellows, and the general answer is because the patient is comatose or patient is stuporous, so we cannot perform the neurological exam. I think that is precisely the moment that you want to have a very focused neurological exam on those patients. And for me, that solves a lot of confusion in the problem. There are many methods. This is a very easily administered scale in the ICUs, Glasgow Coma Scale, commonly used and very easy to administer. We can teach someone Glasgow Coma Scale assessment within few minutes, actually, and it can help us delineate the level of confusion or ladder level of alteredness in a patient. Just one drawback: if a patient is in locked-in syndrome, the GCS would come out to be falsely 3. Other than that, it has been a wonderful assessment tool in the ICUs. This is another assessment method for outline of unresponsiveness. This is known as four score, used and developed in Mayo Clinic. And as you can see, there are four different categories. We look at the breathing patterns and the motor movements and the eye movements, and give the four scale assessment to the patients. So there are several methods to direct the neurological assessment on our patients, and we should be employing all those strategies. For me, this is a very important slide, and the reason I brought it up is you look at the differential diagnosis with impaired consciousness, and overwhelming majority of the time it is neurological. Look at the biggest blue over here. It's 24% of the time it is cerebrovascular conditions which cause the altered or impaired consciousness. A big chunk of the time it is epileptic seizures, 12% of the time. A lot of time these are non-convulsive events, and look at the intoxicants. I mean, they are much less likely, once we have ruled out through urine drug screen, to be the cause for the altered mental status. So my point over here is, if I see a patient with the altered mental status, I try to focus on the focality on the of focality of the neurological assessment. So that is a key point for me. Differential diagnosis we all know about, and let's see, say for example, neurological causes, most common reason behind altered mental status. And as we can see, 50% of the time, it is neurological reasons. It could be seizures, meningitis, or strokes. And we have to be very careful in assessing those patients. This is one of the studies completed by the Jean Plassin group in the neuro ICU at Columbia University. And you look at the toxic metabolic encephalopathy and unexplained decrease in loss of level of consciousness. And about 20% of the time, the reason behind the altered mental status was non-convulsive status epilepticus. So it is a pretty common diagnosis in our ICUs. And a lot of these patients are actually in MICU, not necessarily in neuro ICU, where the incidence could be much higher. Other causes, I mean, medications. We had a wonderful talk just a few minutes ago. Benzodiazepine is a big factor. It's a huge factor for being altered in the ICUs, and we should avoid it as much as possible unless it's really needed, particularly in the older patient group that we generally see in the MICUs. Metabolic derangements. I look at the patients, I do the focal neurological exam, I look at their medications, and the third thing is about metabolic derangements, whether they have hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia, how severe that is, or whether this is a combination of hyponatremia, hypernatremia, or metabolic, non-anion gap metabolic acidosis, along with other medication abuse, because we know this could be a multifactorial condition, and most commonly it is a multifactorial condition. So the evaluation and diagnosis for me in altered mental status should be dictated by the clinical condition of the patient. Index of suspicion should be high for the neurological causes behind the altered mental status. I cannot overemphasize the clinical examination. And the diagnostic evaluation can include CT, which is a very, very simple test to do. So any patient which is altered for no reason, in my opinion, should immediately get a CT head when we see findings that we are not anticipating, especially in neuro ICUs. So it's not uncommon. For the management, I have a two-tier strategy for patients admitted to the ICUs. First is prevention and the risk assessment, and then the management of acute change in mental status. This stratification for me allows to carefully manage patients at risk of delirium. And we have multiple scales, and we can use those scales. And usually those are employed in our ICUs, but whether it's a CAM scale or other scales, but we should pay particular attention if someone becomes CAM positive. We should look for a particular diagnosis just before using the term toxic metabolic encephalopathy. Sedatives, pain medications, and anxiolytics needs special attention, and I minimize the use of sedatives and pain medicines in the ICU unless or until it's really needed. So these are the NICE guidelines, the National Institute of Health guidelines to minimize sedation. First thing first, we look for the risk stratification and which patients are at higher risk for developing altered mental status and delirium in the ICU. Cognitive support, simple strategies, and these are not even considered major medical interventions, like maintaining day-night routine and providing patient with orientation about where, who, and what, and reminding them about the orientation helps in the decrease in the delirium in the ICU. Multi-component package that we minimize the pain medications, sedatives, fluid balance is important. Sometimes they develop conditions very common in neuro ICU, like hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, or fluid overloaded, or congestive heart failure, or pulmonary edema. So these causes are a significant cause for altered mental status. Assess for hypoxia, infection control, I mean, this is our number one etiology after the cerebrovascular and medications. Like patients have toxic metabolic encephalopathy, probably because of undiagnosed infection in the ICU or UTI. Pain control should be optimum, but it should not be over the board. So if someone is on, a lot of times in ICU, I see a lot of sedatives and pain medications, like they are on fentanyl or dilaudid or morphine, a lot of a combination of opioids, especially for the older patients. I try to minimize those and use as judiciously as possible. Daily medication review. And last thing is sleep, promoting the sleep, day-night sleep cycle, and providing the patients with the normal sleep patterns helps them avoid altered mental status. We discussed this in the last talk a little bit. I mean, our number one goal and treatment strategy in pharmacological treatment of delirium, which is an ICU related, is antipsychotics or Haldol, or we use atypical antipsychotics like Seroquel or olanzapine, sometimes really risperidone. But we like to avoid benzodiazepine as much as possible, because a lot of times, paradoxically, I see more agitation and more delirium with benzodiazepine's overuse. So that's one point, that's one key point, apart from the focal neurological exam. Unless or until we are dealing with the alcohol withdrawal syndrome, I would like to avoid benzodiazepines in my ICU at least, and go from there. So let's look at some cases, and that will help us explain how I think about the altered mental status in the ICUs. So this is a patient I saw in Lutheran General Hospital. A 60-year-old male was admitted to SICU after a successful four-vessel bypass. Surgery was uneventful, and anesthesiology reports estimated blood loss of 300 cc's during surgery, no other significant events, extubated in the OR. Post-surgery, patient had a RAS of -2 to -1. Patient was vitally stable, vitals looked pretty good post-surgery, and was transferred in the ICU with no other issues. He was slow to wake up and to follow commands for the first few hours of surgery. ICU nurse, who had just completed her NIH stroke scale certification for the neuro ICU, noticed less movement on the right side, right? This prompted acute stroke alert. Attending neurologist concerning for the left MCA stroke, and we had a whole pathway for the STAT CT and CTA and CT perfusion. So the point I'm trying to make over here is patient was confused and not following commands. It does not necessarily always mean he's just delirious because of being in the ICU. He arrived in the ICU maximum couple of hours ago. He was probably not following commands in this case because he was aphasic. He could not understand the commands. So this was the subtle point that I was trying to make in diagnosing the focal neurological abnormality. And the nurse was brilliant in this case, and she picked up less right-sided movements. CTA showed the left ICA terminus thrombus, and CT perfusion showed a mismatch of around 80 cc's. So the patient was taken to the neuro IR suite, and there was a successful mechanical thrombectomy after the CABG. And patient started to follow commands post-procedure with improvement in the mental status, which was, as I said, was technically aphasia. And MRI showed small infarcts, and he was discharged to rehab. And I think he showed up in our clinic a couple of weeks ago, and he's doing pretty well. So this is really important. Focused focal neurological deficits, if they are present, they should direct us to the focal neurological abnormality and the diagnosis. So really important point for me, because I cannot overemphasize how many times I've seen patient is comatose, we cannot perform the exam. Patient is sedated, we cannot perform the exam. Well, this is precisely the movement. We should be performing a very, very close exam on this patient. Another patient, a 71-year-old woman was admitted with COPD exacerbation. Her past medical history was significant for classic diabetes type 2, CKD, hypertension. So a very typical patient for our MICUs. Physical examination showed lethargic movement, woman with a blood pressure of 95/60, a little bit tachycardic, oxygen saturation is 91% on 5 liters of oxygen. and a temperature of 101. So classic COPD exacerbation. So she was started on COPD exacerbation treatment, and UA also showed bacteria with the leukostase positive and 100 plus WBCs. And patient was admitted in MICU under observation status with sepsis protocol. She was started on cefepime, 1 gram per day empirically, and cultures were sent. Admission CAM ICU was negative, and patient's WBCs and clinical examination and pictures started to improve. However, a few days later, she became CAM positive. So there was a change in her mental status, and we'll see how we approached it. It was attributed to the ICU delirium and metabolic encephalopathy earlier. Her mental status deteriorated further, and she became more lethargic the fourth day of admission. ABGs continued to show hypercarbia, a low PO2 on 5 liters of oxygen. She was started to help BiPAP to help decrease work of breathing. Next morning, residents noted myoclonic jerks, and neurology was consulted. Obviously, neurology came and thought about doing some investigations. She had a CT. CT was negative. We did an EEG, which showed moderate diffuse slowing, with occasional generalized sharps, and CT head was obviously, as I said, was negative. She was started on Keppra, and cefepime neurotoxicity was suspected. So this is another incidence where the cefepime actually was inducing subclinical seizures. And as we know, penicillin and cephalosporins and cefepime, they're the number one cause of subclinical seizures in the ICU now. So cefepime was switched to levofloxacin. Patient started to improve. And a few days later, she became CAM negative and discharged next week to home. So I have these two cases just to point out. Like think about the neurological causes behind it. 50% of the time, the delirium in the ICU could be neurological. Number one, focus on the neurological examination. If you can pick up abnormalities on the neurological examination, that may direct your workup. And subclinical seizures are very common, even in toxic metabolic encephalopathy. 20% of the time, or 1 in 5 patients can have subclinical seizures that we are not picking up. So that's the moral of the talk over here. We'll be taking questions. Okay. Thank you so much.